Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're in Sacramento, California on the Sacramento River for fall salmon. And then we're gonna visit a perfect little mountain lake in Northern California for trout. Now if you wanna learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned.
I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television. This morning, we're launching near downtown Sacramento, California on the Sacramento River with guide James Netzel, along with a crew including his father Ed, Fidel Campos, and Ernie Marlon. In this stretch of the lower river, we typically have warmer than ideal water temperatures, conditions well suited for the flasher and super bait combination.
So I've got a rotating flasher here. I got 3 feet on the front and 3 feet to the back on the cut plug. It's a Brad's cut plug. I think that color is Twisted Sister. I can't tell you for sure, but it's been a pretty hot lure lately. I use a three-way splitter. I don't like the three-way swivel. I tend to get my dropper tied up in my main line and turns into a big old mess. I have 50-pound leader here. I used to use 25, but I started breaking too many fish off, so I went to 50. And if you notice, there's swivels everywhere. Swivel, 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 swivel. There are swivels everywhere. The reason for that, we got witch's hair, which is a nasty weed out here. It's a little real oily, clogs up your swivels. You get one piece of witch's hair on there, that's useless. You get a piece of witch's hair on there, that's useless. So we get a lot of line twists. So you can never have too many swivels. So I got a 3 foot dropper on here, so the lure will probably be flashing a couple feet off the bottom. In the back, we'll put a 2 foot dropper on 10 ounces of weight. And we'll actually go 30 feet on the front, 40 to 50 feet on the back, and it keeps us all separated. So I got a 15 pound dropper. That way, if we do hang up, we just lose the weight, which is a lot cheaper than losing the flasher and the cut plug. When we put our lures in the water, we do it always in this manner. You put your lure, your flasher, and then your weight. If you put your weight in first, everything is gonna go shooting off and you're gonna have a big old ball of junk. Also, you see how the splitter's all nice and set up. Sometimes it'll get twisted up. You wanna make sure it's the splitter's all separated before you put it down. So we're gonna leave the clicker on. You're gonna go back 30 feet. And you're good. We'll throw it in the holder. So I already pre-filled before we left. I had everything set up for everybody. I put tuna inside it. You can see it sticking out of the hole there. I used the tuna that's packed in oil. Tuna packed in oil, that's it. Do I recommend chicken of the sea? I don't care. It is the cheapest stuff I can find and it works. So I'm just gonna flash the lure, mess up our eyes, but the fish can see that a little bit better.
This one right here is called the Hot Tamale, and it's been a really popular color as well. It's been producing a ton of fish out here on the Sacramento River.
Oh, so should we grab the rod right away, or do you want to wait for what
preferably
signal to?
I'd like you to leave it in the rod holder. Just leave it in the rod holder, turn the reel at a steady pace. Most of the time, nothing's going to happen. It's just going to be pulling out drag. But if that fish decides to swim at the boat, we're going to be able to keep pressure on it. So we'll leave it in the rod holder until we get all our other lines cleared. And then we'll tighten up the drag, speed up the boat, and we'll start fighting the fish. This is a new technique down here. I started it last year, and a lot of people laughed at me because they've always been told that plugs or spinners or jigs were the only way to catch salmon in the Sacramento River. And all this stuff's being used way up north. All this stuff's being used up north in the Columbia River and Washington, And they say, no, the stuff that works up there doesn't work down here. Well, that's bogus. The salmon is a salmon. Whatever works up there is going to work down here. We've even had people try pluck cut herring, and they've been caught catching them in the river. So I got laughed at a lot last year when I was using this. People would see me with all this stuff and laugh at me. And now 75% of the people are using this, and all the guys down here are using it. So it is working good.
Welcome back to the Lower Sacramento River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're with guide James Netzel trolling super baits and flashers for salmon, a new but effective technique on the Sacramento. The erratic action and long leader required means that having the right rod is critical for this type of fishing.
So I'm looking for 1 second pulses. 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 1,000. That every time it pulses like that, that flasher is making a whole circle. That's kind of the optimum presentation we're looking for. If you see it going faster, more than likely there's a weed on the flasher. If you see it just kind of pulling really gently or really just different, it's got a weed on the lure or on the splitter, so we need to reel in and clear that. So having a rod that will let you see the pulse is what we want. I want a rod that's got a good stiff backbone, and it's also got a fairly, I want a strong tip, but I want a soft enough tip where I can see the pulses. I also want a soft enough tip so that if the client's ever reeling the fish and gives it a little bit of slack, there's a little bit of pressure still on that pole. So this is a 955 Cousins rod, Columbia series. I absolutely love them. The composite handles, nice and long. It's 9.5 feet long. Up front, I have the 1056, which is a 10.5 foot rod. The reason we have really long rods is we got 7 feet of leader between our weight and our cut plug. So when we get that fish next to the boat, when that rod's doubled over, that fish is still 7 feet underwater, and I can't net the fish when it's 7 feet underwater. So I got long rods to help bring that fish up.
Well, that's a nice one.
First fish of the day. Let me know if he's gonna come toward you. Okay, reel down to it and lift up. Woo! Pull me some slack. Beautiful fish. Look at that cut plug, ha ha ha, right in the corner of his mouth.
So we're fishing here in Sacramento River, and in the stretch that we're fishing right now, it's actually producing some really nice fish because, you know, we're not far from the ocean, so these fish are nice, clean, and really bright.
So optimum water temperature for any fall run salmon up here is 53 to 57 degrees. That's when you can put a lure in front of a fish's mouth and have pretty good confidence that he's going to hit it. And when we're over that threshold to 57 to maybe 65 to 68 degrees is what we deal with in Sacramento most of the year, the cut plugs and the flashers tend to work better. And when it cools down into that lower temperatures, it seems like the Brad's killerfish start working better once we get below 57 degrees.
Now up next, we're going to a very remote Northern California lake for trout. But first, I want to show you a few things that might help you with the type of fishing you just saw in the Sacramento River. Now first, you remember James telling you about how important swivels are for fishing super baits. Well, the Fishfield Tornado swivels are just awesome. They're a chain swivel, they're very high quality, and they're a good price. And also, I would recommend switching out the hooks that come with the Brad Super Baits to these Tornado Treble hooks. That offset bend on them is going to dig into that fish better, and you're going to get more solid hookups. I've had some good reports out of California on these already. Or, if you want to use a single hook, the Gamagatsu Big River hooks are by far the most popular. Now, for your flashers, Fishfield has come out with this flasher bag that's just specifically designed for these types of flashers. What a great way to keep everything organized, clean, and protected from getting scratched and stepped on and everything else. Now, when we come back, we're going to an awesome little lake way up in the mountains of Northern California for trout. Stay tuned.
little barbarian nightmare. Good stuff. Put a little blue light on it. Try to get a glow going. Can you have that little blue light flashlight right up front there?
The fact that in America we still have access to clean lakes full of healthy trout is something that we should all be proud of and not take for granted, despite other problems we may have. Today we're on one of those lakes with AnglerWest Pro Team member Sambo Lage, along with Gary Edminster. Small lakes like this, which we will call Secret Lake, that have only wild trout, are the epitome of old-fashioned trout fishing, but they can't handle intense fishing pressure. So, if you decide to find your own secret lake, make sure you have good tires that can handle the rough roads, and take care of the treasure that you have found.
Clean little guy. Fire tiger. Nice good color on these guys. Nice color. So if you're out in a little lake like this, and you're not sure what's happening or, you know, how, what do you got that's gonna make them bite, put that crip lure out. And depending on the weather, what your circumstances are as far as light goes. Like a day like today, we're running that fire tiger. I like the glow white with the orange head, also crip lure. They're pretty go-to and deadly, especially on top. And best to get them back as far as you can. If you run in two, run them, strag them, one at 250, one at 150, so you don't get all fouled up, but you catch fish, big time. All right, so we put out a little original sling blade, one of the original small ones there in silver, and then the white wiggle hoochie. They like the little wiggle hoochie here. Another nice little guy. You know, it's fun. A little nicer. Put a little Pro Cure up in there. I use trophy trout, a couple of nuggets in there. Sweet. You know, this is Shasta tackle, which is now Mack's lure, and this is the wiggle hoochie. And I guess, you know, Mack's now offers the bills, and you can build your own stuff. And not only that, but you can buy the wedding rings and stuff like that, and you can build your own little components. But this is great action, works like an apex, and is a real good creation. This thing is always deadly on lakes like this. All right, well, we've been catching a lot of little guys. It's been a good topwater bite. It's getting late though. I think we're gonna cruise on in, put some steaks on the grill. Morning at Secret Lake. We're gonna try for some big trout today. Got a break in the weather. We're blessed. Beautiful. A lot of little guys in here. Not bad. It's a typical Secret Lake trout. Look at the colors. Nice orange fins.
We're just gonna keep the bigger fish today, let the little ones go. So we're targeting big fish.
This is the Glow Crip Lure. Now put out by Mack. Really productive color early in the morning when it's overcast or just about any time. So with the Crip, you can pretty much do anything you want. If you're gonna run it down, you can put a double D Mack on there, sling blade, whatever you want, Dodger. What we're doing today is just a long 6 pound leader to a barrel swivel roll, and this seems to work pretty good. Put a little Pro Cure on there. We're using trophy trout today.
Yeah, we're going about 2.5. Seems to be the right speed for these trout. And we'd like to be back about 200 to 250 feet, just because when you go over these fish, they scatter. And being far back, you know, gives them a chance to catch up to your lures. So that seems to be the magic distance, 200-250. The farther to the back, the better.
Up, I was down about 12 feet with the wiggle hooch, and I think this has got a sling blade on it. Can't remember. And we were also running a scent chamber. Yeah, got the small original on there. It's not bad. There's a bigger fish in here from that other area. So that's the white whale. Beautiful fish, man.
And then this is the original little sling blade. I like running these guys. They bend real good. See the little slight bend I got in there, so it puts a lot of action on it. So we're going to keep a bunch of these for eaters today.
We just put this Kastmaster out and just got hit.
There you go. That's more decent. Yeah. A little more decent. There you go.
Nice little 12-incher. Yeah, I like these Kastmasters because they're solid brass and they're real heavy and you can cast out quite a ways from the boat. And sometimes these fish will move away from the boat, so it's good to take one of your spinning reels and rods and throw it out, get it away from the boat, and see if we can get a bite on. Like that. I usually like to let it sink a little bit and then start reeling.
Welcome back to Secret Lake in the mountains of Northern California. I'm Justin Wolf. We're trolling for trout, which tends to push fish off to the side of the boat, making casting a lure such as a Kastmaster a deadly technique, along with lures trolled behind the sling blade.
Nice one. It's 12 feet. See, they're liking that little sling blade. And we're going pretty fast. We're going 2.7 right now. So the water is 51 degrees. It's pretty cold, and these guys are on top feeding. I don't think there's a lot of natural bait or shad in here, so they're feeding on insects and stuff. And they get a little lethargic, so they don't fight as crazy as they probably should, unless you get a big old brown. The browns fight a lot different for sure, but still fun, and they're still real nice.
Came back in this cove and threw this Kastmaster out from the bow of the boat. That's slam. It's on that green Kastmaster. Same color as these trout. They're hitting the same color. There we go.
So you gotta make sure when you're throwing the Kastmaster that, you know, it sinks fast. As soon as it hits the water, it's going down. So you wanna do the retrieve kind of right away. Give it just a little count and then start reeling it in. And they follow it right in there and slam it. So, he's hooked good. I'm gonna pull him out.
What we like to do is we like to put the scent inside this crip lure. Seems to work best.
All right, so when I'm running top line stuff, I like to run the fish field chain swivels. And the longer ones are good because if you get fouled up with junk in here, that you still have stuff working for you. And it really helps with line twist, especially when you're running a leader that long and you got a lure that's actually, the action is moving and spinning, and otherwise without this your line is going to be totally screwed up. So they work really good. Looking good. That's dripping. Gripping.
Crippler?
Yeah,
Crippler.
It's a light fire tiger. It's an older one that I had in there, so it's not as bright as the newer fire tiger. I think it's glow.
A little decent. Nice clean trout. Good for the frying pan. These trout in this lake are like an eagle strain trout, and their meat's real pink, real good eating, good on the smoker.
Yeah, so you know there's lures and there's bait. We're gonna put a little natural bait on the Wiwahoochee, because they're feeding off worms. With the high water rising in here, what it does is wash these things off and they gorge on them. So any little enticing piece like that will really help out. So you do that and put a little procure up in there. I like going right up inside there. This is the white Wiwahoochee. We took off the sling blade just to run it by itself. The big brown that we got here last time was on a white Wiwahoochee without sling blade. But the sling blade's been working, but I just wanted to see what would happen. And as soon as I put it out, pop one right by itself. So you can run these with or without. It's all by itself. He's a little bit bigger as we get him in, but Hooked good too, they hook good.
I very, very rarely lose the fish on this thing.
So put them in a box.
All right, so we just let the fish hawk down on the downrigger, almost to the bottom. Should give us a reading for every 5 feet with the temperature.
So we'll see what we got going on here. So we'll put view. So 10 feet, 50 degrees, 15, 52, you can see as it goes down. That's interesting. Huh, 30 feet, all the way down to 45 feet. It's about 51, it's close to our surface temperature.
At 25 feet, it's 10 degrees warmer, so that's interesting. So I don't know if that means maybe the lake's starting to turn, or it's kind of where the stratus is down there on that, at that depth. So we want about 55 degrees. We're 52.1 on top, 51.6 at 20. Interesting.
We got to read them about 59 degrees at 35 feet, which is a little bit warm for trout, but since the bite has died, we're going to go down to that depth and see if we can get some action going.
We're marking a lot of fish. This one's showing some arches, and we're all around that 30-foot mark, so they're liking that 60-degree water, which is kind of weird.
Yeah, so after we got the reading on the fish hawk, we dropped down 35 feet and picked up a little brown down there. So he's liking that thermocline area. And there's some nice browns in here. It's okay. Yeah, so not bad. There's some big ones in here. And there's a lot of them in here. I'm surprised we haven't picked any more up, but beautiful, beautiful fish.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.